allowing me once again to share my thoughts on Brexit. I'd like to quickly introduce myself. My name is Andrea and I'm one of two directors of the Language Hub in Glasgow. We are a community interest company. Snacks. And our organization has been impacted on by this Brexit vote since most of our staff, including myself, are not British passport holders. We think about Brexit every day. As it has changed the place we call home and our position in it drastically. Since the Brexit referendum, what has defined us has not been our professions, our relationships, our hobbies, our contributions to society, or anything we care for that matters to us and to people in our lives. No, what we are now defined by are our passports. And in my case, that's the Swiss. As I am a Swiss citizen, the result of the Brexit referendum had not come as a massive surprise to me. In Switzerland, we hold referenda several times a year, and I recognized the rhetoric before the Brexit vote from recent years in Switzerland, when conservative and right-wing parties and activists started to blame everything on the EU and, of course, on foreigners. If this is happening in a country with an extraordinarily high standard of living, and one that is not even a member of the EU, it didn't surprise me that in a country with a high child poverty and unemployment rate, to see that this type of scapegoating has had its appeal for many people. What they seem to forget is that soaring food prices and stagnating wages affect us too. I too work and contribute in this economy and society, and I too pay more for food, gas, petrol, train tickets, and so on. I too care about the NHS, the homeless, and the disabled. However, I understand that it's difficult to see what we have in common in a time when the media and the government underline our differences and point at their finger. In light of a declining economy and standard of living in the UK, it is easy to understand why many EU nationals have already decided to leave and fewer are interested in coming into the UK. It's not because we may not be allowed to live here. The question is, do we want to live in a country where we are vilified and discriminated against? Where we have to go on special lists as if the government didn't already know everything there is to know about us? Do we want to live in a country with a dwindling economy, zero-hour contracts, low pensions, and a government that was investigated by the UN for human rights abuse? And once we leave, who are they going to blame? Who will be responsible for deserted universities, hospitals, care homes, shops, and schools? In a country where studying can be as expensive as buying a flat, who is going to replace us? So you see, Brexit is not mainly a concern for us immigrants. But when Liam Fox gets excited about making our own laws after leaving the EU, everyone's blood should chill. What else is the government willing to sacrifice in their desperate attempt to secure trade deals with dubious partners? Food safety standards? Workers' rights? Parental rights? Why would it be a good thing that the Conservatives pledged to abolish the Human Rights Act and replace it with the British Bill of Rights? Can we trust someone who has a problem with human rights? As I mentioned at the beginning, I'm a Swiss citizen, thus not a new citizen. So why do I even get involved in this? Switzerland has bilateral agreements with one of which is free movement. This gives me the same rights as you, EU citizens have, apart from the fact that I'm not able to vote in local elections. These agreements sound really great, yeah? Of course, they come at a cost. Not only a financial one, but Switzerland has to adhere to a variety of regulations it did not have a say in. The bilateral agreements that took a decade to negotiate and several referenda to pass come as a package. And as we don't live in Brexit fantasy land, there's no cherry picking on either side. This is very challenging, as Switzerland is a semi-direct democracy, and we hold so many referenda every year. Some of them threaten our bilateral agreements, with the EU as voices talking about EU dictatorship and lost sovereignty are becoming louder. But for most of us, the sacrifices mentioned previously seem a fair price to pay for agreements on free movement of people, civil aviation, agriculture, public procurement markets, environment, and Europol, to just name a few. So when Brexiters talk to me about sovereignty and escaping the EU dictatorship, I am lost for words. To compare a country with the electoral system, in which the electoral system allows a majority government to be elected by a minority share of the vote, and which entertains a chamber of hundreds of unelected lords, to Switzerland, is at best uninformed. To call a referendum carried out on vague ideas and false promises, the will of the people, makes a mockery of democracy. To use this as an excuse to create an open, new, hostile environment towards people who have been members of your community for years and decades is morally bankrupt. The damage that has been done in a relatively short time is enormous, and now I wonder what this means for my family. Will my son grow up in a society in which his mother is not welcome? Will he be bullied at school because he's not entirely British? Will we be hassled at the airport because we either don't present the same passport or we both present the Swiss one? And what about my Scottish nieces living in Glasgow, who are 9 and 5 years old, who were too young to vote in this referendum and don't yet understand how this Brexit thing everybody talks about will affect their lives? Will they be trapped on these islands with a non-caring government that has gambled away the future? Their possibilities to study, work, and live abroad, their chance to fall in love with someone from France or Spain without having to worry about whether their salaries justify their relationship. So you can see Brexit affects us all, no matter what color our passport is. It is time to stand together and make everyone understand that we are all losing out in one way or another. Let's stop this nonsense. Thank you very much.
I'll start off with giving you a little bit of background about myself. I was born and brought up in Germany. My father's German, my mother's French. I've had dual citizenship from birth. When I finished school, I took a gap year to work and travel around Europe, and I applied to study history and philosophy at University College Dublin. After 5 years in Dublin, I ended up with 2 degrees and 2 broken relationships but no job. So I then decided to study one more course, which was a business degree with EAP, which was an offshoot of one of the French Grande Ecole and a cooperation with the Paris Chamber of Commerce. The course involved studying in Paris, Oxford and Berlin, and all the lectures, coursework, exams, and 3 months work placement in each country were in the local language. My first job was in London in the marketing department with UPS, and that was in 1992. I met my other half, John, 2 years later, and our daughter was born in the year 2000. We moved to Scotland because of John's work, and because he still needed to travel frequently for business and still does, we decided that I would stay at home and be a full-time mum. We first lived in Forfa and then settled in Meagle, where we are still today. It's a great community and I love living there. After moving to Scotland, I completed my training as a breastfeeding counsellor with the National Childbirth Trust. The NCT had given me excellent support after our daughter was born, and becoming a counsellor allowed me to give something back to society. I joined the parent council of my daughter's primary school, became a Sunday school teacher, and then an elder at our church, amongst other things. So that's a little bit about me and my background. I can't remember when I found out that as a non-British citizen, I would not be allowed to vote in the EU referendum. My first reaction was to find out whether I could keep my German and French citizenship if I applied for the British one. I could. Then I checked if from the British point of view, I could keep my German and French ones. I also could. The process of gaining citizenship seemed to be straightforward, according to the Home Office website. It was anything but. I bought the book for the Life in the UK test, and for the test you need to learn all the facts from the 170-page book, and then answer 24 questions online in the form of multiple choice. Many questions are deliberately designed to confuse, so unless you know the facts 100%, you're going to get it wrong and you're going to fail. You must answer at least 18 of the questions correctly. You can sit the test again if you fail, but you must book another appointment, travel to Edinburgh, because that was the closest destination, and pay another £65. I passed the test in March 2016. That was the easy bit. The test was one of many hoops to jump through. The next one was the residency card. You can't apply for citizenship unless you already have a residency card. The application form was 85 pages. I read it through again and again and again. And then I broke down in tears. I googled solicitors in Dundee specialising in immigration, picked one at random and made an appointment. Yes, she could help me, but there was absolutely no way I would be able to get the residency card before the referendum, never mind citizenship. No chance then to get onto the electoral roll and vote in the referendum. I felt disenfranchised. My views didn't matter. At that point, I decided to postpone applying for the residency card and instead join the Remain campaign. If the outcome of the referendum was to stay in the EU, I would not need to get British citizenship. After all, I already had two nationalities. The only thing I couldn't do was to vote in a general election in the UK, and I could live with that. Every spare time was now taken up with leafleting, and I tried to rope all my friends into coming with me. Very few of them did. Most didn't. I could not then, and still cannot understand, the general apathy that most people had, the feeling that things will be all right. Ever since Boris Johnson had come out on the Leave side, I had been worried and feared that the Leave side would win. To see Gisela Stewart on the Leave side and as chairperson shocked me just as much. I distributed leaflets on my own to every house in Meagle, on foot and by bike, in sunshine and in rain. My last leaflet on the day before the referendum went to a friend of mine. She tried to reassure me. "It'll be all right," she said. I started crying. She paused and then said, "We were going to ring a German friend in Edinburgh and ask him if he's packed his bags already. But seeing your reaction now, maybe that's not such a good idea." On the day of the referendum, I accompanied my 91-year-old neighbour to the polling station. On the way, a local organist told me he was going to vote Leave. He said he didn't want to be forced by the EU to play at gay weddings. I was speechless. I spent the afternoon standing with another woman from the Remain group in front of one of the polling stations in Dundee. I will never forget the taxi driver who pulled up, opened the window, called us over and said, "Right, I have no idea what to vote. What can you tell me? What about the 350 million on the bus?" In the evening, I attended the count in Dundee as an observer for the Remain side. Watching all the crosses in the Leave boxes, my heart sank. I felt faint. I heard first results in the car on the way home. The next morning, I emailed my friend and asked her, "Shall I pack my bags now?" I can't adequately describe how I felt. Sad, disappointed, disillusioned, threatened, angry, lost, with the rug pulled away from under my feet. I can't count the times that people both before and after the referendum said, "It's not aimed at you. Don't take it personally. You'll be all right." Or even, "They're not going to deport you." Aimed at me or not, this concerned me personally, just like it concerned every other person who had come here from another EU country and made the UK their and their family's home. It affected me to the core. I was not wanted. Had I been single, with no family in the UK, I would have left the country at this point. But I had no choice. Our daughter was still in school. My partner is British. With the UK leaving the EU, we would not be able to live in Germany or France permanently, because while I would be able to live there, John, as a British citizen, presumably after Brexit, would not. To complicate things further, John might be asked by his employer to move to France or Belgium, because it's a Belgian company. Of course I could go with him, but what about coming back to the UK? Residency, permanent residency, is acquired after living in another country from the EEA, that's the European Economic Area, for 5 consecutive years. But when you then spend more than a certain number of days per year outside the UK, you automatically lose your residency status. So if we were to move to France, say for 3 years, I might not be allowed back to the UK. John, as a British citizen, of course, would, but I would not. Perhaps you understand why I didn't sleep well at night. I was shocked at how the atmosphere in this country had changed. In the village, fruit pickers were no longer called fruit pickers. They were now foreign workers. It was a subtle change, but I noticed. Language matters. For weeks after the referendum, I woke up every morning thinking it had all been a bad dream. I was so upset I found it difficult to speak to people because I felt they were all against me. I had to reframe my thinking and remind myself that almost half of those who had voted probably felt just as disappointed as myself. However, not everybody was as affected as I was and as all the other EU citizens in this country were. Many of them still are. We had been told we were not wanted. The will of the British people. To this day, when I hear this, I cringe internally. The British people do not want me. But if those 3 million people of EU nationals in the UK, like myself, had been allowed to vote, the vote would have gone the other way. Of that, I am sure. I deeply resent not having been allowed to vote in a matter that personally, existentially concerned me and my life, as well as my family. 6 weeks after the referendum, I sent off my application for the residency card. Fortunately, I'm one of these people who keeps every single document and never throws anything away, so I was able to provide all my monthly payslips from 1993 to 1997. And then, all the documentation to prove that I had been resident and present from 1998 to 2016. It was a big packet. Constructing precisely on which exact dates I had been out of the UK for the previous 23 years was a challenge. In October 2016, my MP, Pete Wishart, invited all EU nationals in his constituency to a talk in Perth. Pete explained that the Scottish government's view of immigrants differs from that of the British government. Scotland needs and welcomes those people from EU countries who come and live here, work and have children. To hear, personally and officially, that each and every one of us in that room was welcome and a valuable member of society brought tears to my eyes. It was the first time that year that I had been told this. It meant a lot to me. It took over 3 years, three months for my residency card to arrive. And once I had it, I applied for citizenship. I'm grateful to my family, my close friends, and my solicitor who helped me through this difficult and unsettling time. Many people, including some in my family, I'm afraid to say, got thoroughly fed up with me talking about Brexit. Hasn't stopped me though. My application for citizenship took 5 months from the time of submitting it, and the total cost was over £2,000. I'm aware that not everybody can afford this, nor does everybody have all the documents they need, or the time or the energy to devote to reconstructing the details of their life like I did. During the week when my citizenship ceremony took place in Perth, my mother happened to be visiting us, which was a complete coincidence, so she and John came with me to the ceremony. and celebrated later with a tea party at home and then with a folk session in the pub in Migo. One close friend later said to me, "I'm really pleased for you. I can only apologize that you had to go through all this." He was one of the few people who really understood how I felt. In the meantime, I had attended another meeting with Pete Wisher, to which EU nationals were invited. I'm very glad I went, because that's the meeting where Andrew stood up and announced that a new group had been formed called Perth for Europe. Though I'm sure I would have found this fantastic bunch of people sooner or later, one way or another. Surely it is infinitely preferable for countries to fight each other while sitting across a table, as happens in the EU today, than to fight each other in the trenches, as happened 100 years ago, and then again within another generation during World War II. Both my parents were evacuated and separated from their families as children to keep them safe during the war. That was the Second World War. I'm determined to do everything I can to prevent this happening in Europe again. And one way is, in my opinion, that this can be done is by supporting Britain's membership of the EU. Surely the EU deserves some, if not all, the credit for spreading peace throughout Europe. There were many times during 2016 and 17 when I felt that the situation in the UK had certain similarities to the atmosphere of the 20s and 30s in Germany. A deeply divided population, a large proportion of people who feel left out, a growing fear of speaking out by the general public, by representatives of public institutions, and by politicians. A lack of respect for experts in whatever field they happen to be, the branding of judges as enemies of the people, the disregard for due legal process and disrespect for legal institutions. Democracy is very precious, so please, please, if you're not already, get involved for the sake of your and my country. Thank you. A bit about my journey from almost safe certainty to safe uncertainty. I've been living in Scotland since 1992 with two short interruptions. I came here by chance through a job offer which came about because Britain had not enough doctors. My plan was here to stay here for 6 months and then to go back to Germany. As I was preparing for this talk, I frequently thought about how positions in life change constantly. Things are settled and predictable. And as one gets used to this, they shift quickly, making us feel unsettled and uncertain. I grew up in East Germany, and with the fall of the wall came uncertainty and great opportunity for me. If I'm honest, I would have chosen to work in France, because I liked the language, I learned it in school, and I had to take evening classes to add English into the language mix. However, it was Britain who offered me the opportunity to work. From a young age, I always loved languages and the excitement I thought would lie in a foreign country. My life in Scotland started in Stornoway. I felt very welcome here and made lots of friends and met my future husband during those 6 months. People were very keen to share their life, help me out if I had any struggles with language or culture. I was most touched when I returned to work after 6 months' travelling period, and as I returned to the ward, there was a banner hung up, "Welcome home, Claudia." I stayed in Scotland, worked in Edinburgh, Perth, Dundee, and Fife. I got married, we have three children, two of whom have left home. Over the years, I've completed my training and have been working as a psychiatrist for over 11 years. I had fully bought into the system, primary schools, secondary schools, NHS, European and Scottish elections, to name but a few. There was a bit of sadness when there was a general election and I couldn't vote. But then there was also a bit of relief because I didn't have to make up my mind. And the first past the post system might mean my vote would have got lost anyway. And maybe herein lay the problem that the idea of Brexit was first voiced and gathered momentum. I had long stopped voting in German elections as I had not lived there for many years and thought, because I lived here, I contributed by working and paying taxes, Britain and I were good. But that was not the case. As I had grown up in a divided country and had been taught a lot by World War II,
I really like the concept of a big Europe. I buy into the idea of working for the greater good, of overcoming differences and achieving a joint goal. Maybe as a German, this has been made easier for my generation, as after the war there had been restrictions imposed to ensure Germany could never set on a destructive maverick course again. Even if it did not want to bend to others' will as a country, it had to. I guess if one examines how all the 28 countries adapted to the European Union, I'm sure there are many differences. But I wonder if for a lot of people there is a feeling of certainty of belonging, like it is there for me. That same feeling got eroded in the lead up to the Brexit referendum. A referendum I was not allowed to vote in, because I was not a British citizen. Something that had not mattered for 24 years suddenly mattered very much, and I could not change it. Then I decided to apply for citizenship, and I wrote a blog about it, so I've got a couple of things from this blog. Day 1, end of January 2017. I have decided to apply for British citizenship 6 months after being completely flummoxed by the Brexit referendum result. Waking up on the morning of my 50th birthday to a yes vote was not what I had hoped for. Although watching the debates in the 2 weeks leading up to it, I thought the result might just be that. I have felt quite paralysed since. In one part of my life, I work in the NHS, being involved in the thick of it. In the other, I have felt lonely, vulnerable and isolated. This is despite being a resident in Scotland for more than 20 years with a Scottish family and various friendship groups. Initially, I took it quite personal, wondered in each interaction, were they in or out? Or did they think I had no right to be here and should I leave the country? Then came the question, should I leave the country? Followed by, I think I'll be alright. The lassitude of the last 6 months has given way to, I want to stay and I want to be able to vote. I want to have a say in the country I have chosen to live in and that has become part of me. I never knew that in accordance with the Immigration Act 1971, I can be deported the day after Brexit is triggered, if no agreement about a definite leave to stay for European citizens has been reached by then. My next blog was, or one of the next ones, Safe Uncertainty, beginning of April 2017. I have just arrived at home and found a big envelope. Looking at it, I was hopeful that it contained all my original documents that I had handed over with my residency application. When I opened the envelope, there's a letter and a blue card. From that looks at me, my photograph. This is my UK residence documentation for a national of an EEA state. I cannot believe the sense of relief I feel. I want to cry. I could not have predicted my reaction to this, as I have not wanted to feel stressed by the uncertainty, and have tried, or thought I did just carry on as normal. I guess in my emotional state, I have to deem from unsafe uncertainty to safe uncertainty, from not knowing what my position in Britain is after Brexit is triggered, to at least knowing I have a right of residency. It also says on the front of my new blue card, you are advised to produce this document to the immigration officer whenever you leave or enter the United Kingdom. This makes me feel slightly uncomfortable and potentially singled out. I will have to work out over the next few days why that evokes that feeling in me. For today, though I think it will be a gin and tonic and some more reading of British history, and of course working out what needs to be done for step 2, applying for British citizenship. Over the next few weeks, I sat the light on the UK test and the language test, and on the 16th of May 2017, I lodged my application for naturalisation. I had my biometrics taken and waited, and in late October came home to a letter which made me write this poem. I have no face. I have no face. I'm just a number. Where is my place in Britain's Brexit London? I want to go home. But where do I belong? I came in the 90s from a country that does no longer exist. It went to be united with a part that was not communist. It's home by the Baltic Sea, or in the mountains where I love to ski. Or is it in an island out west where garlic put my English to the test. I was welcome to you, young and green. To live and work in Scotland, I was very keen. I loved to ceilidh dance, that and hill walking led to romance. 25 years on, and 3 children later, I'm still here, and felt I belong. But obviously I was wrong. Thought I was so smart when I received my residency card. I'd given details of 22 years of whereabouts, of when I was in the country and out, only to come back for a week away to find I have 3 days to see. Here is more proof that in this country was my roof. In the 5 years past, I really am dust. The process is set to achieve that Europeans give up and leave. After paying £2,000, which often cannot easily be found, I am just a number. I have no name. The sad thing is, for many, my belief was just a game. After involving the Glasgow Herald and my MSP, I was granted citizenship in November 2017. So this was the last entry of my blog, another poem. Day 321, 14th of December 2017. It had never been my life's ambition to bring into fruition more than one nationality. Now I'm going for number 3, if you count East Germany. You will not believe it, I got married today in a snowflake flurry to the Isle of Theresa May. We have been courting for 25 years, mutually supporting each other as peers. We shared many a sandwich, we did not need stealth. I learned your language and helped your health. The last 18 months have been very hard, as somehow you refused to play your part. I thought we'd agreed to stay together, facing the worse and the better. We have come to an agreement that allows me to vote, to voice my opinion, and for you to take note. From today I am British, I am happy to say, I no longer feel skittish about being able to stay. The ceremony was respectful to the 7 of us who boarded successful the citizen bus. They gave us some shortbread and a wee cup of tea. Then we left city chambers, deputation anxiety free. There is still a chance that we may part. You asking why? Well, there's the issue of Scotland for a start. It is now 3 months since I've become a British citizen. I have a British passport, but could not quite bring myself to use it on a recent trip to Austria. I follow the Facebook group 3 million, and the uncertainty remains for many European citizens in this country for whom it is less straightforward to get citizenship, or whose country does not allow dual citizenship, or who feel incensed by the suggestion they may want to become British citizens. I feel calmer as my stay in this country is not in jeopardy, but I remain as bewildered by Brexit as before. I still cannot understand what the benefit of it may be, as Britain seems to ask for the same economic rights, with no equal contribution to the European kitty. As they say, there is no such a thing as a free lunch. I'm hoping for a second referendum where the information is more balanced and people can make properly informed decisions. I'm also cross how much Brexit has distracted me from putting energy, for example, in my work as a child and adolescent psychiatrist. There are so many issues on our doorstep that benefit from immediate attention rather than figuring out how to leave the Union that benefits us economically and contributes to a peaceful Europe.